welcome to General Tips for Cloning Success. We want to give you some general tips for success in the lab. Some of it may sound trivial, but most of it was learned the hard way by someone. Tip 1, respect Murphy's Law. If anything can go wrong, it will. In actual fact, as you get more experienced at the bench, this is not always true. You will, in fact, get very proficient at many techniques. But as you start out, you can bet that the one time you decide to skip even the most trivial control, that will be the time it really mattered. By paying attention and adhering to the tips we are about to share with you, you will give Murphy a run for his money. Tip 2, make abundant, high-quality nucleic acids. There is no substitute for good starting material with few contaminants. To achieve this, carefully follow DNA purification procedures. Plan on making more than you think you will need. It is always easier to dilute something than to concentrate it. Tip 3, accurately quantitate your nucleic acids. In many ways, this is a corollary to the above. If you make abundant DNA and RNA, you will most likely be minimizing impurities. You will also optimize signal-to-noise ratio in the quantitative measurement. Hopefully, you will have access to a nanodrop which allows accurate quantitation of small volumes of DNA. Well-purified nucleic acids have a characteristic curve over the measured UV spectrum, as seen here. Absorbance at 260 nanometers is used to quantitate DNA, but the overall shape of the curve gives an indication about the quality of the material. This image from Thermo Fisher compares the nanodrop spectrum from pure DNA to some samples with the shown contaminants, guanidine and phenol. The problem with impurities is twofold. First, the impurity can be an inhibitor to a downstream reaction. Secondly, the spectrum of the inhibitor can interfere with your accurate quantitation of your nucleic acids. It is always better to use a sample, such as sample A, that shows a good curve and ratios but has less material, perhaps 250 nanograms per microliter, rather than sample C that looks like it has much more material but also contains contaminants. Tips 3 and 4 work together closely. Make abundant, high-quality DNA, or RNA, that is accurately quantitated. Tip 4, carefully store and handle your DNA. Store your DNA frozen to protect it from UV and oxidative damage. If you need to purify DNA from an agarose gel, avoid exposure to shortwave UVB. Use the longer wavelength UV option UVA that most UV gel boxes have. The best option is to use a non-UV lamp with the appropriate dye so that no damage is introduced at all. Tip 5, understanding molar ratios and when they matter. For many protocols, you need to be aware of the molar ratios that you are combining, and many protocols will indicate what molar ratio you are striving for. You cannot simply just mix 100 nanograms of fragment A with 100 nanograms of fragment B and expect to be in range for the reaction to work. Not if fragment A is 10 kilobases long and fragment B is only 250 base pairs long. The rule of thumb to understand the relationship between DNA mass and molar concentration is to remember that the mass of a DNA molecule is directly proportional to its length. Let's take a look at an example. SnapGene includes a DNA calculations tool to help you access many of the relevant physical properties and calculations about any particular DNA fragment. Here, SnapGene shows information about two different DNA molecules. First molecule is the intact Puc19 plasmid. You can see that full-length Puc19 is 2,686 base pairs long, and its molecular weight is 1.66 times 10 to the 6 Daltons. The second fragment shown is a small oligonucleotide used for sequencing, called M13 Puc reverse, with its molecular weight a mere 7,000 Daltons, roughly 500-fold less than Puc19. You can see that one nanomole of primer weighs just over 7 micrograms, whereas one nanomole of plasmid weighs over 1.5 milligrams. If we mix these two fragments together, just based on their mass, we would have over 200 times more moles of primer than we would have of plasmid. Is this a good or a bad thing? It depends on what we're trying to do. For most cloning experiments, insert-to-vector ratios will be anywhere from 2 to 1 to 5 to 1. For PCR, you want thousands more moles of primer than template. When performing molecular biology reactions, the optimal molar ratio depends on the size of the fragments and the specific technique being used. In addition to the SnapGene DNA calculations page, most molecular biology companies offer handy online calculators optimized for their products. Tip 6. Learn to pipette as accurately as possible. Pipetting is a learned skill. The less deviation you can introduce via pipetting, the better. Accurate measurements and strong replicates begin with accurate pipetting. Along with proper technique, be sure to use well-calibrated pipettes and use a pipette appropriate to the volume you are dispensing. Tip 7. Double-check your work. You may have heard of the old adage, measure twice, cut once. Double-checking your work is universally a good practice, whether in carpentry or science. In the context of molecular biology, it comes into play in many places. Double-check your calculations. Become aware of what various volumes look like in your pipetters and Eppendorf tubes. Does it look like the right amount? If it doesn't look right, it's probably not. Constantly double-check your labels as you are pipetting material in and out of tubes. Those small tubes look very similar, unless you look at the specific labels on them. Tip 8. Save your reaction intermediates. Not unlike saving frequently when you are working on the computer, you should save intermediate products as you proceed through a cloning procedure. For instance, let's say we performed a ligation of a GFP fragment into a Puck19 vector in a 20 microliter reaction. You would proceed to use 5 microliters of this reaction in your transformation. Now, save the remainder of that ligation reaction in the freezer until you know your transformation worked and you have a good clone. This protects you from unexpected mishaps, technical or just random. Did you put your plates in the wrong incubator? Did somebody accidentally not label the plates correctly, use the wrong antibiotic? Lucky for you, you have 15 microliters left of your ligation to transform some fresh, competent cells. Saving reaction intermediates can save both time and money. This habit takes the place of Control Z on the computer. Tip 9. Safely store and accurately document your finished products. Most reagents have optimal storage conditions. Note these and store your materials correctly. In addition, your lab will have established guidelines for storing your work, particularly your finished products. Tip 10. Don't depend on kits. When doing molecular biology, you will use commercial kits for many techniques. Kits are a time-saving asset in a lab and often increase uniformity of results. Nevertheless, do not use them blindly. Spend the time to learn how these kits work. There will come a time when a kit might not work as expected. Understanding how a kit works and what its limitations are will help you with troubleshooting. There may also come a time when there is no kit that can fully address a question you want to ask, and you might be forced to improvise. Building a full understanding of techniques will improve your outcomes in many ways. Tip 11. Keep your cloning projects as simple as possible. Minimize steps involved in your cloning protocol. All the steps you choose should be enhancing your outcome. More steps mean more chances for conceptual error, technical error, loss of yield, mislabeling, and even mutation. This idea of keeping it simple resonates with our final tip. Tip 12. Understand what you are doing and why. Learn which steps require attention to detail and which do not. Some French cooks will tell you, you can never have too much butter. Working in a lab is similar to cooking in many ways. Some steps do fine running too long. Some reagents do not need to be measured very precisely. Other reactions are better off if your ratios and temperatures are reasonably close, and yet other techniques require absolute precision. When starting with a new protocol, it is safer to assume that all the steps require equal precision, but as you gain experience, you will learn which steps require more attention and precision and which steps do in fact have some wiggle room. Let's recap our general tips for cloning success. 1. Respect Murphy's Law. 2. Work with abundant high-quality nucleic acids. 3. Accurately quantitate your nucleic acids. 4. Carefully store and handle your nucleic acids. 5. Understand and know when to apply the concept of molar ratios. 6, learn to pipette accurately. 7, double check your work. 8, save your reaction intermediates. 9, safely store and document your finished products. 10, learn how not to depend on kits. 11, keep it simple. 12, understand what you are doing and why. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.